Hello, everyone, and welcome to Best Thoughts. I'm Will Johns.
And I'm Rick Johns. And today we are joined by two very special guests, and we are so excited, and you should be excited too, because you don't have to hear us this whole podcast.
All right, yes.
Yeah, so we are here with Dr. John Nixon and his wife, April, and these two have an amazing YouTube channel called Just John and April. So welcome, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Glad to be here.
And we are so excited, first of all, to be recording on your amazing sound equipment. So listeners,
so much better.
If this sounds way better than normal, it's because we are on a Rodecaster Pro. And I don't know how much this thing costs, maybe $50,000, but...
$45,000.
Okay.
But anyway... John and April, I want to start off because our listeners may not know you all that well. We want to hear about, how did you guys get together?
You mean like getting married and stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah. So long ago. Like,
how did this happen?
Do you remember the story?
I'm getting old, man. I don't remember anything. So we've been married almost 21 years, and wow. I guess we dated for 3.5 before that. So we're talking, I don't know, almost 25 years ago.
Yeah, but when we first met, we were 13.
That's true. So it's even longer ago than that.
Yeah. Oh. So
early romance. His,
right. Yeah. Teenage love.
Yeah, yeah.
Was it love at first sight for either of you? Or?
Actually, I need him to answer first.
So I was, okay, so obviously I'm 13, right? I was definitely, I thought she was really cute. But I was 13, so I mean, I wasn't like, you know, we weren't dating people or anything like that.
No, and then. I thought he was way older than me. So I was like, okay, this was like a crush for me.
Do you mind, like, for the record, just saying how much older than you I actually am?
See,
everyone wants to tell me what that meant.
7 years, so, okay? Years.
We look like we're 7 years apart. Everybody just assumes, you know, I'm way older than her.
Look, we went to some church members to visit one time, and the lady was like, oh, you brought your daughter. I was like, yes.
Your
yes.
daughter.
Oh,
yes.
Wow.
So this is like super
really
early. This is like my first year of ministry. I'm like, what? Daughter? Come on, man. She was dressed differently. She had on like school clothes.
I wore glasses.
She wore glasses. She doesn't have glasses anymore. She got LASIK since then. Mm. And so when I met her, she was with my cousin, who is like my favorite cousin, because we're around the same age. So my favorite cousin is April's best friend, and we don't know each other.
Wow.
But we have this link. And so immediately we're like asking about each other through my cousin. After we left camp meeting, we're like
sending
messages back and forth to each other, man. Stuff like that.
Yeah.
So but it's like marrying family.
Sort of.
A little bit. It was like my cousin.
Yeah.
But you know.
It was weird.
What
at
is
first.
It? Like fifth cousin removed?
Yeah. Fifth
so
cousin
it was okay.
Removed. Yeah, it was fine. You know what I'm saying? But I was seriously, people used to say things about how April looks like my mom. And they would say stuff about how we kind of look alike, just joking.
Yeah.
And so I was slightly, like, no joke, I was slightly worried.
Yeah, because his grandpa's from North Carolina, my family's from North Carolina.
Right.
I was like, babe,
right.
We need to look into this.
Right. So when
this
we got the,
not
you,
be
you
good.
Get your test done before you get married, I was like, oh, Lord, I hope we're not related. This will be bad. So obviously we weren't. And our kids came out okay, so that's fine, too. That's the real test, by the way.
That is the real test.
And how many kids do you have?
We have two.
Okay.
Two
John,
teenagers.
Yeah, John is 16.
Okay. Mm.
Julia's going to be 14 in August. So about to have two high schoolers. Wow. So we feel really old, guys.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but I feel great because I feel like, man, we're going to be alone in our 50s, late 40s.
Yeah, John will go to college. We'll be in our late 40s. That's really good.
Yeah.
We're going to have empty nest pretty
early. I mean, we're going to go crazy.
Yeah, yeah. It's going to be weird around here.
But you're looking forward to it. That's a good sign for the marriage.
I think so.
Yeah.
It may
not
say
that
something.
We don't like our children.
We love them. Yes, yes. We love them.
Yeah, I mean,
but you know.
Most of the time.
We're not interviewing you for your parenting tips.
Right.
So true. That doesn't matter at all.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
We're just trying to kick them out.
We know you're terrible parents, but you're great at marriage. So
yes,
that's what we come
exactly.
to ask you about.
Right, right.
So 21 years, two kids. What are some fundamental secrets you've learned along the way? Because you guys, I've watched some of your videos. You guys have an energy, an excitement, a passion about marriage. You have fun together. Like, we don't see this in couples everywhere. Mm. I see a lot of couples that just boy, it makes me worried. They just look like they almost hate each other sometimes.
Right. Yeah.
So what have you learned along the way?
Man, you know, there's something that we've always had that I don't think we even tried to necessarily work on. And that for some reason, we just have a natural affinity for each other. There's a lot of things we like to do together. I think it's actually largely because April's, like, she's really effeminate, but she's really a tomboy. So she loves, like we work out together. We do extreme sports together. You know, we've talked about it, Rick. April and I have done what you've done a million times. We've done a mud run. Mm-hmm. And I think, I don't know how many you've done. You've done like 12?
Something like that. Something like that.
Sure. Yeah, and we only did the initial, you know, the little, what do you call it? The not the beast. What's the little one called?
The sprint.
We did the sprint. Right. You've done all of them.
Yeah. You
know? And I got injured during just the sprint. Exactly. So, you know.
but she likes that kind of stuff. And we do that kind of stuff. We watch sports together, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I think that helps us in a lot of ways because we're friends. And one of the things we've found in our studies is that when you are friends with each other, mm-hmm. there's this thing Gottman talks about called positive sentiment override. It's this idea that even when you're in a problem or an issue, the positive sentiment that you have for each other sometimes overrides the negative sentiment that, that wants to creep up. That helps us a lot.
And
it
so really does.
We kind of lean into that and we try to tell, in fact, we have a course on how to become your spouse's best friend. Because a lot of people don't work on their friendship. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But that helps really in a lot of ways. I think that's helped us a lot. Because we've had issues.
And it makes me not stay mad at him for it.
Correct. That's what I'm really saying.
You know.
Even when I do something or she does something, we don't stay mad at each other very long because we do have this sort of positive sentiment override that takes over for us a lot of times.
Yeah.
But we've had some tough times in our marriage.
We have.
I think year 7 was really tough. That was bad.
Yeah, was it 7?
Was that the cancer year?
That. Yeah, so that was about year 8.
Yeah, so we had, I can think of 3 major life incidents that happened that were real tests for our marriage. The first one happened like
7 months after we got married.
Yeah, we got into a major car accident, and that like really shook us.
Because we hadn't built that strong marriage yet,
right?
You know, and here we are in this serious traumatic experience, and we're trying to get through it with only 7 months in the bag.
Tough. Right. That's tough.
So
that's
that tough. Was very difficult.
And it was actually really bad. Like this accident that we had, we should have died. Yeah. We went over a cliff, like 30-foot drop. I fell asleep at the wheel.
It was bad.
Yeah, and my brother and his it wasn't his fiance at the time. It was his girlfriend then.
Yeah, yeah.
But my brother and his girlfriend were in the back seat, and everybody got seriously injured from it, including April. I really didn't, so I had all this guilt. It was a real problem.
It was bad.
And it lasted for a while. We ended up having to get counseling.
It lasted for years.
It did.
And we didn't even realize that was the... I mean, we knew we had those issues, but you don't think that that's the thing, you know? And so we had to figure that out on our own, really, because we didn't really have the tools that we have now.
Right.
So...
Yeah. Yeah. So we had that. We had kids. Having children, I think, was a major thing for us in terms of...
Mind you, we got married at 21, 22.
Right.
So that added to it.
and then I think the other big one was I had cancer. Mm. And just going through that, I think.
Yeah, and our kids were really little.
Yeah.
So that was tough.
Right.
Can I ask a question about the car wreck?
Yeah.
Because
I think we have probably some listeners who are maybe newly married or even just going through something in their marriage right now. What did you learn going through that you wish you had known prior to it? You said you were new, so you didn't have all these tools.
Mm-hmm.
What would you tell someone, maybe someone gone through COVID and their marriage is right on the rocks right now?
Yeah.
What did you learn going through these hard times that allowed you to make it work?
Well, I know this is cliche, but it's because it's true, and that is communicating.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I kept so much to myself. So I felt like I was going through that alone.
Okay.
And that was very tough because you're thinking in marriage, you'll never be alone again. Mm. Like that's what you go in, you know,
thinking.
Yeah,
you have this person the rest of your life.
Right.
You're never going to feel alone again.
And
then you feel lonely in marriage. It's like, what is going on?
Yeah. So I went through that. I think John, I'm not going to talk for you, but.
No, what were you going to say?
Well, I was going to say, I think you felt kind of alone in a way, too, because you had this guilt that you were dealing with.
I was going to say, yeah, my guilt was huge. It was yeah. So what I would say I learned and wish I knew then, I wish I knew then understood the value of counseling,
I was
going to
say
therapy.
That, too. That was my next one. Because we didn't even think. We didn't even say we need therapy. Like, at least you say it, you know, and then you don't go follow through. You don't follow through. That's what most people do. They say, oh, I need a therapist, and then they don't follow through. But we didn't even say we needed to talk to somebody.
But this is back in 2001, and I think back then, at least for us, our age group, our community, I think—
No one was doing that.
No one was. In fact, it wasn't as normalized as it is now.
It's like premarital counseling, yes. Right. Everybody does that. Right. You get married, and
but
then that's it.
But you don't, you're not crazy for doing premarital counseling. If you're getting therapy, there's something wrong with you.
Right.
And so there's this automatic sort of negative thing that goes along with it. You don't even consider yourself needing that. But I think what happened was our minds were in an accident, too. I mean, so we had physical injuries that were
like
obvious.
PTSD,
we had mental stuff we didn't know.
Seriously, we did. Yeah. I mean, I couldn't even ride in the car for a few months.
And actually, she would be afraid to go to sleep.
Yeah.
Because everybody in the car was asleep. This is like, this accident happened like 3 o'clock in the morning. And so it was like, you should have been sleeping.
Yeah.
And we all did, including the driver.
Yeah. Oh my goodness.
That's not good. But I think April had a little bit of guilt as well, thinking because she went to sleep, she didn't stay awake to keep me up. And
right.
So there was all this stuff we were dealing with. I actually ended up having an accidental counseling session. So this happened before we went to the seminary. We were pastoring in a small district when this happened. And about in year two is when we went to seminary, right? Mm-hmm. So this is like, I don't know, a year after the accident, right? Went to seminary.
Right.
So I was taking pastoral counseling, and one day in class, he asked for a volunteer so he can demonstrate a counseling session, little 15-minute thing he was going to do. I don't know why I raised my hand. I just raised my hand. I said, okay, I'll do it. So he brings me up front, sits me in the front, and he says, hey, share with us, if you don't mind, share with us a traumatic experience that you've gone through. You know, nothing big or whatever. And I said, you know what? Actually, I've been in a car accident recently. And I told him the story.
Yeah.
And guys, it wasn't supposed to happen. We took the rest of the class period. It was about 50 minutes. It was like a regular counseling session. By the end of the session, well, first of all, I remember this question that he asked me. This actually changed my life. It rocked my world. He said, because I was explaining that it wasn't anybody's fault. And he said, he said, so you believe the lie that it wasn't anybody's fault. And I was like, whoa. So I kind of pushed back a little bit. I didn't do it on purpose. He said, well, that's different. He said, not doing something on purpose is, or not meaning to do something doesn't mean you're not at fault. Mm-hmm. He said, you fell asleep at the wheel, right?
Mm.
I said, that's true. Mm. Wow, that's a good point. He said, okay, so what are you going to do to help your family members to be released of the guilt that it was their fault? Because I had explained that April blames herself and, you know, all this stuff. And so I started going down the line telling him what I was going to do to each family member. Well, two family members and a girlfriend, basically, to kind of take responsibility for what happened. And then he asked me, what do you think they're going to do when you say this? When you tell them this was your fault, what is their reaction going to be? I said, well, April's not going to accept it. April's going to tell me, stop talking like that. Why? And then he said, well, what are you going to do to make sure she does accept it? Guys, it was literally life-changing.
He told me to shut up.
I did. Well, I said, so here's what I did. And I gave him my plan. I said, I'm going to talk to her in the bathroom while she's in the shower. And he said, why are you going to do that? I said, because I don't think she's going to be able to look at me. I said, if she's not looking, I think it'll be easier for her to accept what I'm saying.
Wow.
He said, okay, I think that's a good idea. And then he said, what do you think she's going to do? I said, she's going to try to, you know, come back, and I'm going to say, babe, be quiet. Let me just finish. So that's literally what happened.
That day,
I came home. She was in the shower. I came into the bathroom. I said, I got something to tell you. She said, what? I said, I want to apologize for the accident. She said, no, why are you doing that? It was not your fault. I said, babe, please let me finish.
Then he said, shut up.
I didn't say shut up. I may have. Shut up, babe, and let me finish.
I'm taking notes. This should work well.
Right.
Exactly.
And by the end, she was thanking me Because I released her of the guilt of feeling like it was her fault.
Wow.
I didn't even know I needed that.
Right. Wow. And I'm saying, this dude literally changed our lives, man. Yeah. And it was an accidental counseling session in class. Yeah. So April ends up going to him, you know, because he's the counselor.
If I could talk to him. And I went in and I just literally went in. Okay, because this is something, guys, I was holding this in. So I was like dealing with this for
it was like a year and a half. Yeah.
And it was like a constant thought that was going through, which affected our relationship because I was having all these feelings that I wasn't sharing with him. And there was some anger there too, you know, not with him, but just with the situation. Mm-hmm. And so when, you know, all he said was, you know, like, what's going on? That was it.
Dr. Swanson, you
mean. Yeah. And I just went in like for an hour. And then at the end, he said something that just released me again. And that was, if I were you, I would have felt the same way. That was it. Wow. That's all I needed. And I'm like, this is all that we had to do to,
yeah,
to get better, basically. So you're right. I mean, I agree. That was the next thing I was going to say is that, you know, just talking to somebody sometimes helps you to, you know, figure things out there.
So it sounds like to me, like you would say to a young couple to learn from your experience is be proactive about willing to see a counselor. Mm-hmm. If something comes up and the relationship doesn't feel right anymore, just go talk to somebody. Yes. Right. You know, normalize that. That's what we do. If we're feeling sick, we go see a doctor. It's no big deal.
Exactly.
And we're finding it's a lot easier for people these days because a lot of stars are coming out and saying, I have anxiety.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, I deal with this issue, that issue. Yeah. I think it's definitely way more normalized. Back in the day, you know.
It wasn't even an option.
No one's saying
for us,
that.
Like we weren't, that didn't even come to mind.
Right. Not even once.
No.
And you know, we've talked on our podcast and relationships about the importance of counseling. So that's a big thing. So I'm glad you guys are highlighting that. And I think with a marriage especially, sometimes you need that third neutral party.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
And I tell people, if you have a lamp and it falls off the table and breaks, it can't fix itself.
True.
And if the marriage is broken, you need somebody outside the marriage sometimes, especially a marriage.
Yes.
Definitely.
But I also think, Rick, that I'm glad you said that because the objectivity of the third party is valuable even if nothing is really broken.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be where you're at crisis mode see somebody. It could just be, I need a little bit of perspective on this, and I think I'm too close to it to really know. I need somebody who's outside the relationship to really help me to see this. And so that's one of the things we push for people. Don't wait until you're in a crisis. Don't wait until you're about to break up.
And see, that's what we see.
Right.
It's like a lot. We're desperate. We have no other choice. Yeah. And it's like, if you had done this when you saw those first signs.
As maintenance.
Yes.
Maintenance, yeah.
As opposed to like, you know, your axle is broken and you can't even drive the car anymore.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
It's hard to come back from that.
It really
is.
Yeah.
Anyway. That's powerful, man. That's really, thank you for sharing that story and being vulnerable about what you guys went through with that.
No problem.
Then there was a cancer thing.
Yeah, man. So
that was big.
That was big.
Because we had little kids. So that was tough because, I mean, we had, little John was in school, and John had to go through surgery and the therapy and everything.
I mean, I had to do chemo. I did radiation.
Radiation for 6 weeks.
Yeah, I think it ended up being 7 at the end.
Yeah, it was 7 weeks. Mm-hmm. And if you know John, you know he's very active.
high energy.
High energy. And so to see him go from what he normally is to just nothing. I mean, like, I don't mean to say nothing, but it really was.
Yeah.
It was like he wasn't himself at all.
Right.
Yeah.
So that was very difficult. And I don't even know how I ran the house alone. Like, I have no. And John was also at the time getting his doctorate. He had to stop to deal with this. Mm-hmm. And so it was just a tough time. You know, God sent people to help.
Mm-hmm.
But It was tough because I did not know what he was going through. He was very silent during that time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he went through depression, and it affected our relationship to the point where I was like, does he love me anymore?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's what we went through.
Yeah.
You know, because we didn't have that friendship that I was used to where we communicate, we talk about things. It just wasn't happening, and I didn't know what he was going through alone. You know, he was alone in that, you know, because he had his own feelings about what was happening. But so actually, it's so funny, we're talking about counseling. So after he finished his radiation, he had several I guess a couple months even after that, where he was still dealing with.
That's really when the depression set in, was after was the radiation after, was over.
Yeah, it was after the radiation. Mm. And I was like, Lord, what's going on? Like, I thought things were going to get better when it was over, you know. So I was like on my face every day, mm. begging the Lord to just fix this mm-hmm. because I did not know how. Yeah. Okay. Mm. Yeah. So out of nowhere, I think somebody gave us like a free. Trip to the, you know how you have marriage retreats?
Right. Oh. The conference marriage retreat, they said yeah. we could go for free.
And they were
free,
like, hey, so we're like, you guys, right. you can go. We have an extra this or whatever. We're mm-hmm. like, okay. So we went. And that's where I was able to be like, because I just prayed, Lord, I don't know how to bring this up.
Was that in Myrtle Beach?
It was Myrtle Beach.
Because we had a yeah. walk on the beach. I still
we
remember
had a walk
like it was
on the
yesterday.
Beach. I remember too.
And it was one of the things that they said, you know, we won't have a session. You guys go, you know, just have a walk on the beach with your spouse. That's what we were doing. Mm-hmm. And we're, you know, and so April just starts talking to me and basically says, I'm paraphrasing, I need you to snap out of it.
I actually did use those words.
Right.
Like, I look,
and then she started saying
God
what it was like
moment.
To be
like,
around
I need
me
a moment,
lately.
Lord.
You know? Yeah. And, the, and it was something that. That I don't know what it was. Literally, something happened while we were walking. I literally snapped out of it. I can't even explain what happened.
I think he was like, whoa, am I actually showing how I'm feeling inside?
Right.
Am I showing this depression? Right. Yes, yeah. you are. Mm. Like, what's happening? And I wasn't trying to be insensitive, but. Those were just the words. I was like, babe, you got to snap out of it. Mm-hmm. What's going on? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so anyway, after that, we were able to talk. But I just coming back to being in a place where, so it doesn't always have to be where yeah. you're going to a therapist sitting down.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, mm-hmm. just having those times where you're focusing on your marriage, mm-hmm. focusing on your relationship mm-hmm. can bring out those things that you might be dealing with. Mm-hmm. So when we left there, it was like back to...
It wasn't all the way back to normal, but she at least
back, you
got
were back.
The me
yes, he
that was
back.
Able to talk and communicate yeah. and say, this is what's happening.
So then we
and
were
I was
able
more open.
To deal.
Yes,
yeah,
it definitely changed things. No
yeah.
question. And we've been through a lot, haven't we?
Maybe now's a good time to shift gears before we put you back in that depression. But,
thank you. You
yes, guys, we don't want to go back there.
Well, it seems like, and I want to just reflect this, Rick, real quick. It seems like what's happened when I hear both of those stories is something that's kind of weighing on both of you. You're starting to feel isolated from mm-hmm. each other and alone. And somebody through the right promptings kind of pushes through it, you yeah. know, starts a conversation.
Yeah.
And I just want to, you know, reflect that because I've experienced that in my own marriage where it's almost like, you know, and as a Christian, I would say it's the Holy Spirit kind of mm-hmm. pushing yes. and prompting and mm-hmm. goading, mm-hmm. like, you got to talk about this,
right. yeah.
you know, quit mm-hmm. letting it fester, quit mm-hmm. letting it just kind of stew in your mind, get right. it out on the table. Mm-hmm. And that's a phrase I learn from counseling, you know, put it out on the table because when you're looking at it, you can do something about it,
right,
you know,
right.
but it sounded like when it was just in your heads,
yes,
that wall just kept getting built higher and higher mm-hmm. in between. Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's more and more feelings of loneliness. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty awesome, you know, to hear your story and see how, you yeah. know, even when you didn't fully know what you know now, mm-hmm. God kind of pushes you through those tough moments.
Definitely. And I'm going to tell you, I always ask God to give me the right time to mm-hmm. say something. Mm-hmm. Like, Lord, show me, let me know, this is it.
Awesome.
And that's what he did when we were on the beach. It was mm-hmm. like, okay, here's your moment. Mm-hmm. And I had been praying about that for weeks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think that too, because sometimes when it's, well, we know this, when it's not the right moment, sometimes it doesn't
yeah.
work.
And it kind of messes things up.
Yeah, so
even
I think
more.
Praying yeah. for that when yeah. it's something that's deep, mm-hmm. that you really know is going to be a serious conversation, mm-hmm. praying for the right moment so that it can work, mm-hmm. you know, it can happen.
And the other thing I think is fascinating is, you know, God uses this marriage retreat for you guys.
Yeah.
And now you all are creating those moments for other people.
Right. Mm.
Tell us about what you're doing with your marriage boot. Is it marriage boot camp?
It's called the intimacy boot camp.
Intimacy yeah. boot camp.
Right. Yeah. Okay. We just finished our second one.
Yes.
This is only our second one.
That's right. It's called a 30-day intimacy boot camp. Yeah. So basically you just take 30 days, you join us. It's been virtual. It started the first one in March of this year, 2021. So full pandemic type stuff.
Right.
I think it was the right time for a lot of people because... Yeah. As you alluded to it earlier, Rick, I think there's a lot of stuff going on in people's marriages because of the pandemic. Mm-hmm. I think the less distraction you have in life, the harder it is to ignore the things that are really going on. And so a lot of people found themselves during the pandemic saying, wait a minute, is this the relationship I'm in?
Exactly.
didn't like it.
Right.
And so we found that we had a lot of, we had 40 something couples our first time, and it was really great. Mm. So basically what we do is, we have these courses that they can do, which are video kind of courses. And then we have this live coaching call that we do once a week. Mm-hmm. And everybody comes on. It's like Zoom. And then they ask questions, and we just coach them through whatever they're going through based on the topic that was that week. So there are four different topics. Each week, you watch the video, you go through the course. You have these challenges that you do every day. And there's something about just focusing on your marriage every day that people immediately start to see their intimacy grows. And of course, our philosophy is when people hear the word intimacy, they automatically think about the physical aspect of intimacy, when intimacy, of course, is much larger than that. So each one of the weeks talks about an aspect of intimacy that we don't necessarily connect with intimacy. The last week is physical intimacy. Yeah. And our theory is your physical intimacy will be at the place it needs to be at the end of the 30 days because you worked on all the other aspects of intimacy along the way. Mm-hmm. And people have been reporting that after the first week, they literally see something like almost magical happening in their relationships, stuff they were struggling with for long periods of time. And we have the full gamut. We had, you know, newlyweds in there. We had people this last time that had been married 39 years.
Yeah.
Wow. So, and they all report similar things. There was something about being deliberate about our relationship for 30 days that really had an impact for us. So we love it. Like you just said, it's like we've experienced on our end how impactful it can be to just take that time. And we want to provide that opportunity for others. And so it's been great.
Yeah, and the thing we've heard too is couples saying they've actually discussed things they've never talked about before.
That's awesome.
It has brought out things that, and it just helped them to grow. Mm-hmm. It's been great.
Mm-hmm.
And to get to know these couples is really fun.
Yeah,
we go through it every time.
Right.
It's been good. No, seriously, we have breakthroughs as well. Mm. Like this past one, we had a huge breakthrough.
Yeah.
And it was great. And you would think, I mean, not just you would think 20 years is not really that long.
Right.
You know, when you're talking marriage, I mean, it is, but it isn't.
Right.
It's right in the middle.
It's right in the middle. Exactly. You know, but to have a breakthrough at 20 years, we're like, wow, this is great. We thought we knew all the things about our marriage that we needed to work on or things that we could, you know, but this one was, and it was with communication. So it was like, wow, this is great. And we weren't really in the boot camp.
Right. So it's crazy. Do you want to know what the breakthrough was?
Sure.
Okay, so we learned something about real communication.
As we were studying to teach and help our couples.
Yes, that real communication. And there's this couple, they have this podcast called The Love Hour. Is this Christian comedian named Kev on Stage and his wife.
You guys would really like him.
Yeah,
he's hilarious.
He's hilarious. He tells a lot of church jokes.
Yeah.
Anyway, his wife, Melissa, she calls herself Mrs. Kev on Stage. She has this show called The Love Hour. It's the two of them doing like what we do, but they're much better. Anyway, so she had this thing that she was working on. She said, I have a new definition of communication. She said, in a relationship, communication is not genuine unless it has three things. It has to have honesty, vulnerability.
And transparency.
Mm-hmm. And she said, honestly, honesty obviously is just always telling the truth. Transparency is not hiding behind things like anger or resentment or whatever, you know, that are keeping you from really sharing your feelings. And what was the other one I said?
Vulnerability.
Vulnerability is putting yourself in a position to be hurt.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's real communication. So April and I have been... We've been doing this.
We tried it.
Oh my goodness!
Right, so we didn't know. We thought we were already doing that. Let's put it that way.
We weren't even close.
Wow.
We weren't really doing that.
No.
You say especially you, but you don't even know.
You think especially you?
I'm just saying.
Really?
Not that we haven't been communicating, but like just saying it the way that you're feeling.
Yes.
Mm. You know, because I think in marriage we kind of hold that one little thing back because we don't want to hurt the feelings.
Yes.
Because you love your partner. You're not trying to break them, you know.
Right.
But you do want them to understand how you feel. And so for the first time, we had a conversation about a specific topic that we, you know, that one thing that always comes back, that one argument every year. Once a year, you have that big one
yeah.
with that same topic.
It's the same topic.
We do.
Right.
We do.
Yes.
Maybe maybe twice a year.
Maybe three times. Whatever. That's not important.
That's not important. But we finally were able to share our true, deep feelings and being vulnerable. Because you don't, you know, just I was afraid of how he would respond to me when I said to him how I actually felt about that particular topic.
Yeah, and I didn't know what I was afraid of. I think I'm afraid sometimes to actually feel what I'm feeling. It's weird.
Yeah, sure. Wow.
So what I do is I like my go-to move, which by the way, I think everybody has.
Everybody has a go-to.
A go-to like fight mode that isn't good, that makes it worse. Right. My go-to mood is sarcasm.
Oh.
And mine's defensiveness.
Right. Oh, a couple of the four horsemen that we talked about.
Yes. Right.
And then after I'm sarcastic about it, I'm okay being like angry about it. Not real anger, but like just, you know, a little form of like, you know what I'm saying? Like light anger, not really, you know, not wrath or anything.
Well, I hope not.
No, nothing like that. But I'm comfortable with that. And when she said that, when Miss Kev on stage said that, I said, you know what? I'm almost never vulnerable because if I'm upset about it, or if I am sarcastic, then I don't have to actually admit that what she just did hurt me.
Yes.
Which is what I'm really feeling.
Exactly.
Right.
So instead of saying, you know, you're never available during this time for me, blah, 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 I should say, you know, I was really looking forward to the two of us spending some time together, and I'm disappointed that you're going to hang out with your girlfriends tonight because I was looking forward to just me and you having some bay time or whatever.
Yeah,
that's hard. Actually, I feel less manly right now saying it to you guys. I'm not even, you know what I'm saying?
But you were vulnerable,
right?
Right.
That's what I'm saying.
That is.
But I'm saying when she said that, I was like, wow. You know what? I don't think I ever really communicate honestly.
Right.
So we've been doing that, and that's the big breakthrough we had in this last 30 days, guys.
Yes.
20 years in.
So we were able to deal with something that we were dealing with for years, our one thing.
Yeah.
And there was a breakthrough.
Yeah.
Wow.
Because
we were vulnerable.
But the thing is, it's weird because it was very uncomfortable for like 2 weeks.
Seriously.
Like, it felt like we couldn't not argue. Right. It felt like, what is wrong? Right. And so April actually said, this is what, 2 o'clock in the morning, right? Yeah. We're supposed to be sleeping. We're talking about this thing. And April actually says, I don't know what's wrong with us. It feels like nothing can be right. It feels like our marriage is getting worse. Mm. And she said, we're here working on these other people's marriages in this boot camp, but ours is getting worse.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, this boot camp is ruining us. Yeah, it's ruining us. So I sat for a second and I said,
you don't talk at 2 o'clock in the morning.
We have some of our best conversations
then, though.
Because the lights are off, we can't see each other. You know what I'm saying? So I said, you know what, babe? I don't think that's what's happening. I actually think we're closer to an authentic relationship than we've ever been, and I think we're just not comfortable with it. It's uncomfortable to have these conversations, and we're not used to being totally
100% honest.
Yes, it means you're going to be uncomfortable, and the discomfort might last a while. I mean, we're talking 2 weeks now of feeling like, man, I'm walking on eggshells. We can't do anything. Yeah. But now, like yesterday, I said to her, I said, all of a sudden now I feel like we can't do anything wrong. Like, this feels perfect. I said, I think we needed that discomfort for that period of time
and
to get comfortable
said,
with the
yes,
idea
because
of.
Because you remember your response when I said, man, it feels like we're getting worse. What's going on? He was like, this is what happens when you're growing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have to go through these painful moments.
Yeah, that's right.
Sure. You know, it wasn't, you know, a year.
Right.
It was a couple weeks.
Right. Which is long for us.
But what it did was it made it so that now we're feeling better about being totally honest, like right away.
Yeah. Now we're comfortable.
We don't have to sit down and say, okay, babe, remember those three things? Let's, you know, now it's like, okay, this is where we're going to be from now on.
Yes. Yeah.
And it's I love that because now I feel free.
Yeah.
It's like freeing to really be able to, and it's like after 20 years, we haven't really been honest, but it's really being honest with ourselves.
That's really what it is.
I think sometimes you can make yourself think you feel a certain way because you still want to be a man in your mind.
Exactly.
I don't mean to say it like that.
No, that's thank you. Say it the way it is.
They want to be a man. No, I'm just kidding.
They can't see you rolling your eyes on
right, because
you know.
I'm joking, but you know, it's like you have to be honest with yourself. You were hurt or your feelings were hurt. That's hard to say.
Yeah.
For you,
yes.
You know, my feelings were hurt.
Right, right.
Yeah. And that's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway.
That's awesome stuff. I'm soaking that stuff in. But I think listening to you two guys, how you both that's what you learned. You learned that you can be safe for each other. Mm-hmm. And then, like, I love hearing April say, now we're free.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I love, I mean, people need to get in your boot camp because you need both people to commit to that.
Right. Yeah.
Yes.
I think sometimes I see in a marriage where one person is like, I'm ready to go to the next level, and the other person's not there.
Yes. Yeah. Very true.
So I love that you would do this boot camp so both people are intentionally working on it. Mm-hmm. What, when you're doing these boot camps, what common kind of blocks or challenges do you see in people's marriages today? What are some of the common themes that people are wrestling with?
So do you mind if I take this one?
Go ahead.
So there's okay. So our very first course of the 4 weeks, right? Because it's 30 days and it's four different courses. Our very first one is on radical acceptance. Mm-hmm. And that's deliberate because what we find is that this is at the base, at the core of almost every couple's intimacy issues. They have not accepted their partner.
Yes.
Fully.
And I'm talking about radical acceptance.
Fully.
So like, you know, there's like accepting the fact that, you know, April, I don't know, squeezes the tube of, you know.
Okay, just make sure you didn't say anything.
Squeezes the tube of toothpaste in the middle and I do it from the bottom. That's not a real thing in our relationship. We both do it from the bottom, but you know what I'm saying. But I'm saying something like that. Okay, that's not radical acceptance.
Right.
Radical acceptance is like, there's this thing that irks me about April that bothers me every time she does it, but it's not going to change. That's who she is.
Yeah.
I need to find a way to not only accept that, but to see what that is about her that I can actually appreciate. Because we always see these situations and these things as sort of a what it is about it that bothers me. But if we take a backward look or a bigger look at that thing, oftentimes that thing is something I really like in other situations. So for instance, in April's case, she's a very sensitive person. And so if we're in a disagreement, sometimes she might get teary-eyed because I said something that was very direct.
That sarcastic.
Or sarcastic, right.
Right.
We learned.
Let's tell the truth here.
Exactly. And that would bother me all the time. And I would say, man, why are you so sensitive? I learned not to say that anymore, obviously.
That didn't work for you.
That didn't work.
No, that didn't work at all.
I can't believe that didn't work.
And then I might be tempted to really want to change that in her, or even to pray and ask God to take that away from her. Mm. Well, if I step back and take like a 10,000-foot view of her, and I look at that same thing, what I find out is that sensitivity actually shows up in other ways in our relationship that I love. Mm. So for instance, April's called me before and I'll say hello and then she'll say, what's wrong? And I'll be like, how'd you know something was wrong? All I said was hello.
What?
It's because she's so sensitive. She can pick up on those things. So 90% of the time, I love the fact that she's sensitive. Yeah. Here it is 10% of the time we're in conflict. I don't like it.
Yeah.
Mm. I'm upset about it, trying to change that in her, not even realizing that there's something about that that I actually appreciate.
Yeah.
The other side of that same coin is a positive attribute that I love. Now, it doesn't always play out that way, but very often it does. And people don't realize the roadblock to their intimacy is that they have not really accepted their partner fully.
Exactly.
So if we spent more time doing that, man, so our couples, like most of the time, in like, both boot camps, they say that first session, one? In that first week, it changed our entire relationship.
And see, what we see is during premarital counseling, it's like, do you feel that you're accepted? Oh, yes, 100%.
That's what they say all the time.
Of course, you know?
Yeah.
Because you want to get married and you don't want to mess up anything in that situation.
But you really do.
Yeah.
You really do feel like I'm accepted, you know?
Sure.
But once you get in the house together every day.
24/7.
That's right.
24/7, there are some things that you're like, mm-mm.
Yeah.
I don't want to deal with this, or I can't, you know, I don't like that.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, once you're in it and you've had some time, sometimes it can feel like, you know, I don't think I am accepted.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't really think that, but you don't really know that that's it.
And if we help couples and say, okay, maybe you don't feel accepted. Maybe you feel accepted overall, but you don't feel accepted in a particular area.
Right.
Sometimes they're more comfortable thinking about it and saying to themselves,
and I think usually that's the case.
Right.
Yeah.
That there's specific areas where you don't feel accepted. But I think when that comes out, it's great to see how the couples respond to that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and that's a big one for us.
It is a big one.
I think it's so big because I remember, you know, when I was younger in marriage, I was trying to do all these things for my wife, you know, like remember to give her flowers and you know, say nice compliments and this and that. But as I got older, I realized the greatest gift I could give is that radical acceptance.
Yeah.
You know, just letting her be herself no matter what, looking for the good instead of, you know, like you said, John, you know, we judge someone's little thing as like, oh, just because it annoys me, it's like a character flaw.
That's right.
Right.
Being sensitive is not a character flaw.
Exactly. No.
It's a huge, huge benefit.
That's you right.
Know? Thank you.
But we judge it. We judge it as this thing because it annoys me in this one moment.
Yes.
You know? And that's not fair.
It's a very narrow view.
Yes.
And so offering that acceptance, I think, is the greatest gift, you know, and we can get caught up in doing all these little things that are kind of surface.
Yes.
You know? I accept your sarcasm, babe.
Thank you, babe.
I don't know if that's a good quality.
The funny thing, though, it is. Yeah, she loves it. She loves
there,
it.
There's the truth.
There's the truth.
Literally. I actually think it's one of the things she was drawn to when we first started dating.
That is true.
She loved my quick-wittedness and the fact that I could...
But not during an argument.
Right. She hates it then. You know what I'm saying?
When she's on the other end of it.
Yeah.
Right. Like, oh, no, it's not so funny now.
Boy, well, I think we're all like that.
Yeah, it's true.
Well,
I'm just impressed, April, your radical acceptance of John, because he's already confessed so many things he's done wrong as a husband.
Listen, and she's still with me.
Yeah, that's like you have embodied this message that you preach. I think for some people, in some marriages, it might be harder for one spouse than the other.
I will agree with that wholeheartedly. I'm not just saying this. April is like the easiest person to please. If she's upset about something,
remember this, okay?
I'm not gonna forget. And I believe this. This is one of the ways in which I feel very blessed because April never holds a grudge. Mm. She can't stay mad long. If I say the wrong thing and it makes her upset, I can say something nice and change her mood almost immediately. It's great.
Wow.
It's almost. That's weird. I don't know why she has this quality, but it's never gone away.
Yeah.
Now I will say though, there have been stretches and times where, because of what we're going through in our relationship, like some of those times we were talking about earlier, it was a little bit harder to get her back into a good mood easily. I think it's because, you know, some things were building up over time, like during the cancer period or during the time that we're having our accident because she was so burdened.
Yeah.
But for the most part, man, you know, so I feel like I'm very blessed. So I would say it's definitely lopsided in our relationship.
Well, tell us.
Oh, my goodness.
Tell us as...
So she didn't even correct me on that, so she knows too.
You guys are fun.
We'll move on. Yeah. Just kidding.
I know.
So tell me, how do you keep that intimacy? Let's say you work through the radical acceptance, which I think is absolutely fundamental. It's brilliant that you guys start there.
Yeah.
Then how do you build on that? How do you keep that intimacy, or how do you take it to those next levels?
Well, we talk about the spiritual part.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not, you know, when we say that, we're not talking about having worship together, praying, you know, which is very important.
Part of it. Yeah.
That's very important. I don't want to diminish that. Right. But the everyday living, how you treat each other is huge when it comes to intimacy. We think it only happens in the bedroom. Mm-hmm. But when we say real foreplay, because we say that's one of our topics in our boot camp, it's real foreplay. Mm-hmm. And that is outside of the bedroom is real foreplay.
Mm-hmm.
So when you are fulfilling those that love language and you're willing to step out of your comfort zone to fulfill that love language.
Mm-hmm.
That's very difficult sometimes because you kind of love the way that you're loved, but that's not the way that other people love all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's stepping out of yourself to love this person, you know, that is real intimacy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that is where it plays out in the bedroom.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a reciprocal thing. You know, if you are treating each other with that love and kindness and you're being purposeful in that, that bedroom's going to be hot, you know? I hope I can say that on your podcast.
Yeah, right. I don't know.
We can edit that out.
Yeah.
This is a PG podcast.
But she's right, because the funny thing is, I think women understand this much easier than men.
Hmm.
Men don't often connect the intangible sort of, you know, stuff you can't see to the actual physical intimacy. The assumption we make is, you know, if we're good at, you know, I don't know, we do think of some intangible.
Watch it.
You're right, I can't.
PG, babe.
there are certain aspects that I think men say, which we don't do naturally, but, you know, lighting candles or having music or something like that. That's kind of, you know, not yeah. physical, mm-hmm. but still, that is, you know, 10 or 15 minutes before the actual act. We're not thinking long term usually.
Yeah. We're not thinking in the morning.
Right, or the day before.
Or the day before.
Yeah,
you know,
sure.
you know, calling her in the middle of the day to say, or sending a text message to say how much I love her, or, you know, something like that, that sort of leads to a better physical atmosphere when the time actually comes.
Right.
We don't connect those two as easily. But women seem to say, oh, yeah, right, that makes sense. I would love that. You know, because she's already in the mind frame. Us guys, sometimes we're kind of visual and, you know, yeah. we might not be thinking about it at all. And then our wives step out of the shower and we say, oh, wow, this is a good time. You know, yeah. our wives don't work like that most of the time. They need something a little bit more substantial, maybe 30 yeah. hours before.
Yeah.
you know what I'm saying? And well, when we connect those things, a lot of times it pays off in the bedroom in ways that we didn't imagine.
And you talked about the love languages, April. Could you just share real quick in case our listeners aren't familiar with what those are? What are the love languages?
Gary Chapman
yep.
wrote this book called The Five Love Languages. Mm-hmm. And so there are five love languages that he says. How does he say that?
He says basically people know in their minds that they're loved,
right?
Like as you say it or whatever.
That's right.
But you may not feel it. In your heart, if that's a way of
right.
if that's a way of thinking about
so
it.
So you have the five. You have physical intimacy. Mm. No.
Physical touch.
Sorry.
Touch, yes.
We're talking about intimacy. I can't get my mind away from that. Sorry. Okay. Physical touch, mm-hmm. Words of affirmation, gifts,
acts of service,
and
quality time. Yeah.
So that
a person might feel, okay, April tells me she loves me, but because I'm not a words of affirmation person, I might not feel loved.
Right.
Until she does something for me, because I'm actually an acts of service person.
Right.
So speaking
so
my love language
is
simple.
Acts of service.
I am. That's true. And she is
I'm
words
of affirmation.
Yeah.
Okay.
So this is where we have our
yeah.
because
he's
my
like,
words
he's
of affirmation
like zero
love.
Words of affirmation.
Because he's sarcastic.
Right.
Exactly. He's like negative one. Okay.
hey, you
seriously,
look good
guys,
today,
I'm not,
babe.
What?
What did that mean?
And she's pretty low on acts of service, actually.
Yeah.
So this is where we always have our conflict.
And I'm not joking. He really is zero. He really is negative.
And she's not zero acts of service,
I'm not
but almost.
Zero acts of service,
maybe like
but
two.
Almost. I maybe like two.
Yeah.
No, but seriously, like, I mean, there are times when our biggest, you know, arguments happen over this love language thing because
yeah.
we are so opposite in that area.
And what
so,
happens
so
is
so
when I'm
me,
not getting my love language, I sometimes lash out by saying things that are not as flowery, and that affects her love language. So now here we are on empty.
Well, let me ask you this, though. Do you find, John, that you're like always doing acts of service for her?
Yes.
And are
yes.
you complimenting
exactly,
him
correct.
All the time?
Exactly what we
correct.
And then it just kind of
yes.
misses.
He has said to me, babe, that doesn't do anything for me. Stop saying
yeah,
thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, yeah.
That's enough thank you.
Yeah,
stop.
Yeah.
And I'm like, how can you not get enough thank yous? Like, how is that possible?
That's
could
awesome.
Could you do something, please? You know,
yeah.
why are you
like,
saying so much?
Do you ever stop him from serving you, or do you just kind of?
Oh
like,
no!
Yeah.
I said right now, after 20 years, I'm all of the love language.
She'll take all anything.
I'm all of them. So really, seriously, like
yeah.
he doesn't have to stop doing that. But
yes, she has no problem with receiving
no.
acts of service, especially yeah. when they're around specific things that really make her tired. You know, we've got children. Obviously, she deals with kids every day at school, and so she comes home. Well. For a while, she was just coming downstairs from the room because it was virtual. But you know what I'm saying? When she comes home, you know, just bushed from dealing with kids and having to deal with our kids too. And then I do something like, you know, go to your room, take a nap. I'll handle the dinner tonight.
Yeah.
I
That's
mean,
an
who,
act of service.
Who,
and
who
she,
doesn't,
of
you
course,
know,
yeah,
who would not respond
that.
Positively?
Exactly.
exactly.
But here's where the real problem is. April wants that and she's okay with that. But she's not okay with that if it doesn't also come along with words of affirmation.
Yeah.
Yes. So,
so
really
if I do
the,
that
yeah.
and then I'm annoyed and send her to her room with some kind of, you know, negative tone.
Send yeah. her to her room?
Yeah. See, that's the other thing. You know what I'm saying? See what I'm saying? Even that. Yeah.
Then, you gotta work
then
on
she's
your
like,
words.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And she's like,
wow.
Why are you even doing anything for me? What's the point of it if you're not going to also say something kind like, wow. You look tired. Do you yeah. want to take some time? I want you to go upstairs and just take a nap.
Yeah.
When it's like that, she loves it. She'll take whatever other love language it is if it's accompanied by the one she really needs. But I might as well throw it, you know, in the trash can. If,
right, right.
And we have seen and experienced couples that are on empty.
Right.
Of course.
Mm, yeah. I mean, course. It's just not happening.
Their love tank is not full at all because they're not getting their love language.
But it goes back to acceptance. Mm-hmm. It goes back to accepting that this is the way this person loves, mm-hmm. and I'm going to feel that love language because this is what they need from right. me. Yeah. Not yeah. because, you know, because some people really are uncomfortable with certain, especially physical touch. We've had yeah. couples where one does not like physical touch. Right. The other yes. one does.
Yeah, I've seen
and
that.
It's very difficult for that person to show that love language mm-hmm. towards them mm-hmm. because it's so uncomfortable. But that's why I said you got to step out of your comfort zone. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's not possible without doing that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So.
And marriage is intentional. Marriage takes work. And
yeah.
It does.
That's one of the lies I think of our culture.
Yeah.
Like, oh, you fall in love and you just have this magical experience 24/7.
No, absolutely yeah. not.
It's ridiculous.
Well, let me tell you, it's so funny. My sister said, she said to her husband the other day, this is a job.
Yeah. Yeah.
So and I was like, work. It is. It yeah. is. It's a job. It's work. Not mm-hmm. in a negative sense, but that it takes work.
Yeah.
You can't just sit back and relax and think everything is just going to, you know,
yeah.
work out.
Very true.
You have to put forth that effort. Mm-hmm. But in the, because we tell our couples all the time, if you do that on the front end.
Yes. It pays off.
Like now, yes. when yes. we think about where we were mm-hmm. and where we are now, mm-hmm. even, you know, communication wise.
Yes.
I mean, even though we had a breakthrough in that, we still came from a place where, like I said before, there were some things we didn't share at all.
Right.
Right. Right.
Very
so,
true.
You know, it's growth.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I want to ask you about your YouTube channel, yeah. Just John and April.
Yeah.
You're talking about marriage on that channel. Mm-hmm. Tell me just real quick, what was the passion that led you to start that YouTube channel?
Well, before we talk about it, I want to make sure that everybody knows. We try to deliberately be about relationships in general, not just marriage,
okay.
but only because, mm-hmm. only because there are so many people that are wanting to be in a relationship or are in one currently that aren't actually married or are contemplating it. And so right. we kind of talk about it from that perspective. Sometimes we do things for singles and stuff like that too.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We think relationship sort of principles work in any kind of relationship.
Sure.
And so we kind
sure.
of share it that way. But we're passionate about it, about trying to help people to realize that your relationship does not have to suck.
Ah, that's our slogan. To.
That's right, exactly. It's like our little
sarcastic.
Tagline.
Yeah, right. It's so sarcastic. It's perfect, right?
It doesn't have to. Man.
So when we were in Atlanta, we had a lot of young people in Atlanta that we counseled. Mm-hmm. A lot of young couples, mm-hmm. and they were like, "You guys need to be on YouTube. You guys got to do this." And we were like, "What? No way!
Yeah,
like we're
on,
not YouTube people. Right. Like that's not for us." And as they continued to say, we said, well, let's look into it. Mm-hmm. So we had a meeting with this guy who was really good at doing stuff like that and just started talking about it. And when we moved here, we're like, you know what? John bought me a camera for my birthday. We're like, let's do this. Mm-hmm. Let's just try it.
Awesome.
And so, you know, when you look at YouTube influencers trying to get you to start a channel, the first thing they say is just do it. Mm-hmm. Like, who cares if you yeah. don't have everything? Mm-hmm. Just do it. So that's what we did.
Well,
so our first episode
took us like a
is
year
horrible.
And a half to get to that point.
So don't look at episode one.
Sure. You can watch it, but it is
you can
terrible.
Watch it, but it is pretty bad. But anyway, you'll see where we came from.
Exactly. It was about 2 years ago that we started.
Yeah.
And so what we do now is we have a podcast, video podcast episode that drops every Friday, usually around 3 o'clock in the afternoon Eastern mm-hmm. times when we try to do that. And then we also go live now on Facebook. It simulcasts to YouTube as well on Wednesdays at 9 p.m. Eastern.
Okay.
And on Wednesday okay. nights, that's a little different. It's called Ask Just John and April. Ask John and April live is what it is. and people just like in the comments will say things and we will react to it live. It's kind of fun.
It's very fun and it's very
interactive.
Yeah, very interactive. You kind of say we call our
people, audience, we call them the chimes because
they're
always chiming
in.
You know? And so we say, what do y'all think, chimes? You know, and then they say stuff in the comments and it's always funny and really fun.
Yeah, it's really fun.
It is.
And
conversations
we
go different.
We talk about
place.
A lot of stuff.
Yeah, yeah. We talked yesterday about the perception that that all men want to be babied by their women. And the perception on the flip side that men think that all women just like want to take their food off their plate. Like why is it that when I am eating, my wife wants my food off of my plate, even if we have the same stuff?
Same food, same
yeah.
food.
Why is that?
So it's kind of like, mine is mine, with yours is mine. You know, kind of like that.
Yes. And there are many men that think a relationship with a woman that's long-term is going to be, I lose all my individuality, I can't have anything for myself anymore. And so men struggle with that and say, do I want to be in a relationship that's committed because I'm going to lose a sense of who I am? Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So there was that kind of thing. And it was a really fun.
It was a good convo.
We had some guests on last night, both of whom are single, and we just talked to them about what was going on. And anyway, so it's a lot of fun. We really enjoy doing it. And it feels good when people respond and say, we were having this issue, and just by watching your show, we were able to have a conversation about something we've never talked about before. That's probably the thing we hear most often.
Right.
Yeah. And we love that. We think when you watch John and April, what you're going to be able to do is at least talk about something that you've been scared to talk about before.
Right.
Awesome. You know what I'm saying?
Love it.
So we love it. Anyway.
Yeah. It's
so
fun. Cool.
So check us out sometime.
Yeah. So listeners, just John and April on YouTube.
And by the way, we're everywhere else too. Instagram, Facebook, all the same handle, at just John and April. If you look that up, you'll find us. And we have content everywhere.
Awesome.
We're always trying to do stuff.
Yeah.
And then Wednesday nights live, what time Eastern time?
9 p.m. Eastern.
9 p.m. Yes. Eastern time.
On Facebook.
And then the new episodes released on Fridays.
And it is not PG.
Yeah, that's true.
So listeners, be warned. She just warned you.
Sometimes it's PG.
Sometimes it is. You don't know what the chimes are going to say.
When you've got your 5-year-old child in the car, maybe not the time.
That's why we make it 9 p.m. when
exactly.
we go live.
Babies are, in the bed. That's right. The little ones are down.
That's right.
We can get wild. No, I'm just joking.
It's not that bad.
I'm just joking, guys.
We are a pastor and teacher.
Babies are in the bed and more are on the way. I see how you guys roll. All right. Hey, it has been so fun to talk to both of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
We know you're in demand. You're everywhere. So it's really a privilege that you took time for us. So we appreciate that.
Yes.
Thanks for inviting us. We like your podcast, and so it's nice to be able to be on it. And we hope you invite us again.
Yeah, you get the award. You are our very first guest on Best Thoughts Podcast.
Yes.
You are the first guest.
Oh, my goodness. Is
that true?
Great. Yeah.
That's true.
That's not true.
No. You're the first ones we went to.
Wow.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. Nice. That's great.
Now, will it actually air as the first, or will you put us down like, you know, episode 20 so that people hear the other guests first?
You
I'm
just will joking. Air as the first.
Wow. We're excited about
that.
Unless
Thanks,
Brene
guys.
Brown responds.
Right.
We're okay with that.
Yeah.
So far,
she's going to do the show.
We're claiming that.
Exactly.
Well, everyone, thank you so much for listening. Thank you, John and April. And you have been listening today to Best Thoughts with Dr. Will Johns and me, Dr. Rick Johns, and our special guests, Dr. John Nixon and his wife, April. So thank you so much. Have a blessed week.